So, Fermi Paradox. It's finally time. We wanted to make a video on this topic for a long time now, because we see all these videos about the Fermi Paradox on YouTube, and they all suggest really fancy solutions. The Great Filter, the Zoo Hypothesis, the Rare Earth Hypothesis.
But the most obvious one is of course the one we like the least. We are going to argue though that exactly this one solution to this apparent paradox is the most likely one, even though the YouTube videos would like to make you believe otherwise. So stay tuned to find out what solution we are talking about.
In the summer of 1950, at the Los Alamos National Laboratory in New Mexico, you know, the place where the first atomic bombs were conceived and constructed. Enrico Fermi and his fellow physicist co-workers had an interesting conversation about aliens. As the conversation unfolded, Enrico Fermi then at some point famously exclaimed, "Where is everybody?" Basically, what he was saying was that, how come that despite the overwhelming odds for life to exist in the universe, we haven't found any conclusive evidence of life beyond Earth? So this is the Fermi Paradox. By now, we should see alien life everywhere and be flooded by signals. Yet, there is a total lack of any evidence for extraterrestrial life. There are many theories which try to explain this lack of extraterrestrial evidence. We will quickly go over the most famous ones.
1. The Great Filter. This is the most famous one because, of course, it's the most spectacular, and we just love spectacular stuff. This explanation suggests that there is an event that eradicates alien civilizations. It could either already lie in the past and we humans were lucky, for example, the arising of life itself could be extremely unlikely, or the emergence of intelligence itself, or the event lies in the future. In that case, an atomic war or a super powerful Skynet-like AI that destroys its parent civilizations would qualify as a great filter.
2. Rare Earth Theory. This explanation basically says that the occurrence of a planet on which intelligent life can evolve is incredibly rare in the universe. Therefore, almost no intelligent civilizations are created, and therefore they are too far apart to ever be able to communicate.
3. Rare Intelligence Theory. Well, this is just a variation of the Great Filter. In this case, the occurrence of intelligence is just super rare and almost never happens.
4. Aliens are too alien for us to understand. This would mean that even if we detected some signals from an alien civilization, we wouldn't understand the signal to be of alien origin, simply because they might think too differently from us, or they might have evolved to process data a lot faster or slower than us, so their signals might appear as background noise.
5. Cosmic Zoo Hypothesis. This is an entertaining one. It states that very advanced civilizations have detected our presence and have chosen to shield us from other civilizations, creating some kind of cosmic bubble in which we live, like in a zoo, where they can study our fascinatingly primitive behavior, which would also explain the apparent silence in the universe.
6. Interstellar travel is much harder than we think. Well, it could also be that aliens have never visited us, because it turns out that interstellar travel is either incredibly hard or outright impossible, which would be a pity, of course.
7. Building large megascale projects is impossible. A Dyson Sphere is a hypothetical megastructure that a super advanced civilization would build around a star in order to harness its entire energy output. While this sounds nice on paper, it is an entirely theoretical construct and might in reality actually not make any sense or be outright impossible to build.
8. Building a star empire is just not feasible. It could be that even very advanced alien civilizations will either be forced to remain in their own star system because interstellar travel is impossible, or if it's possible, they might choose not to expand because of lack of resources and because the distances involved are just too huge, so that the empire would fragment into just an agglomeration of planets. that would then diverge culturally and later also evolutionary. Therefore, establishing a star empire might really be impossible. Sorry, Romulan star empire.
9. Nobody wants to send signals. It might also be that aliens choose not to send signals because they expect the others to send signals. That would be really funny and a bit sad in our opinion. Just imagine the cosmic joke of millions of civilizations only listening but no one actually sending anything.
10. The aliens are already here. This is of course also a very entertaining one, because it would mean that we are already being studied by super advanced aliens without us even knowing. They could cloak themselves at will or morph into objects or even people without us ever knowing. A variation of this theory is that they have been here thousands of years ago and influenced our history. The ancient astronaut theory suggests exactly this.
Is such a thing even possible? Yes, it is.
We like theories like this a lot for their entertainment value, but they are unlikely in our opinion because they imply that we are a super interesting species, which, let's be realistic, is probably not the case, as much as we'd like it to be.
So this was an excerpt of the most famous solutions to the Fermi Paradox, and there are many more, but what now? Which one is the right solution? Well, in order to answer that question, we must estimate some numbers. But before we do that, please subscribe to our channel, as this would tremendously help us to continue making such videos. Thank you very much in advance.
So then, let's look at some recent studies and numbers regarding extraterrestrial life. A recent study from June 2020 estimated, using Kepler Space Telescope data, that there are 6 billion Earth-like exoplanets circling G-type stars in the habitable zone. Stars are divided into spectral classes and our Sun is G-type. So these are stars similar to our Sun. But only 7.6% of stars are G-type. If we include smaller K-type stars that make up 12.1% of all stars, this number already grows to way over 10 billion potentially habitable exoplanets in our galaxy alone. We don't know yet if planets around the small M-type red dwarf stars would be suitable for life, since red dwarf stars are very often flare stars that emit strong bursts of highly energetic particles, but they make up a staggering 76.45% of all stars. So including all these, we could have around 60 billion Earth-sized rocky planets in the habitable zone just in our galaxy. This in combination with the fact that life arose incredibly quickly on Earth once it cooled off makes the rare Earth hypothesis hard to believe. Even more so, since amino acids, sugars, and other complex organic molecules have been found on meteorites. Thus, it's quite likely that the universe is full of life. But how many intelligent civilizations are out there in our galaxy?
A recent paper published in June 2020 in the Astrophysical Journal set some interesting limits on the number of intelligent civilizations in our galaxy. Here we have to dive a bit into the Drake equation. The Drake equation, established by the early SETI astronomer Dr. Frank Drake in 1961, tries to estimate the number of intelligent civilizations in our galaxy, denoted by N, with which communication might be possible. It takes into account the average rate of star formation in our galaxy, R star, the fraction of those stars that have planets, FP, the average number of planets that can potentially support life per star that has planets, NE, the fraction of these planets that could support life that actually develop life at some point, FL, the fraction of planets with life that actually go on to develop intelligent life, FI, the fraction of civilizations that develop a technology that releases detectable signs of their existence into space, FC, and lastly the length of time for which such civilizations release detectable signals into space, L. We then get the number N of intelligent civilizations in our galaxy, which we could detect by multiplying all these factors.
In the paper, Tom Vesby and Christopher J. Consolis from the University of Nottingham inserted the most pessimistic parameters and got an estimate as for the lowest number N of intelligent civilizations. They found it to be anywhere from 4 up to 211. Yes, there is quite an uncertainty there. Their findings implicate that on average, the nearest civilization would be around 17,000 light years away from us, which is a huge distance and would explain why we haven't detected anything yet. Also, such a low number of alien intelligences would make it extremely unlikely that we would detect a signal, because we would have to have our radio telescopes pinpointed at exactly the right time into exactly the right direction in order to catch such a signal. But if there are only a few dozen such civilizations in the galaxy, the likelihood to look at the right star exactly at the right time is insanely low. Like, stupidly low. Only 120 years ago, we wouldn't have been able to detect any signal. And don't forget for how short a time probably radio waves are being used as a means of communication. Probably radio signals would be to them like smoke signs to us.
But okay, let's say many of them would be using radio waves. Then unfortunately, even if you look exactly at the right time, at exactly the right direction, you also have to look at the right frequency. Despite these insanely low odds, we still managed to find some interesting signals though, such as the famous WOW signal, where we still can't rule out that it might be of intelligent alien origin, or the recent Proxima Centauri signal, and a few other interesting signals. The funny thing is, even if they were of alien origin, we still wouldn't know for sure. So it's not only the odds, but also our detection criteria themselves which make it so unlikely that we find something which the scientific community then deems to be proof.
But then how about the alien technology? Von Neumann probes, Dyson spheres, they should be everywhere, right? Regarding Dyson spheres, there was a search conducted at Fermilab for a few years until 2016 based on the data from the Eros satellite. Dyson spheres have a specific infrared spectrum which would be detectable. Based on a dataset of 250,000 stars, 17 ambiguous Dyson sphere candidates were found, the best one being Eros 20369-5131. You can see that the data points really fit a Dyson sphere infrared curve quite well. But unfortunately, even here, our technology and knowledge of space phenomena doesn't suffice to really prove that this is a Dyson sphere. It could also be a natural phenomenon. And on top, the sample set of 250,000 stars is ridiculously small. And here you already see the second big problem. Our technology is just not advanced enough to even tell reliably if stuff we found are actually alien artifacts.
Oumuamua is another excellent example. For all we know, this could have been a von Neumann probe or a solar sail, yet our instruments are so pathetically bad that scientists still aren't sure what it was. Harvard professor Avi Loeb maintains that it was an alien probe, but others disagree. See, this is the problem. Our instruments are not yet advanced enough to even reliably say if an object that passed through our own solar system is of alien origin or not. Yet people have the arrogance to proclaim that there is a Fermi paradox because we haven't found anything yet. I mean, we ourselves can't even agree if we have found anything or not. And then the odds clearly aren't in our favor. We still use radio telescopes, and if the next civilization is on average really 17,000 light years away, then we have absolutely no chance of communicating with any of them. So the most likely solution to the Fermi paradox consists of two things. First, we haven't been looking long enough, and second, our detection technology is just not advanced enough. But of course, we don't like that solution so much because this would mean that we are doing something wrong and that we aren't as awesome as we would like to think. In the end, it is much more fun to think about spectacular solutions like the Great Filter.
And we like to thank all the people that help us with the channel in one way or the other. These are Zabo Chiari, Jay Keegan, Michael Root, Stefan van der Feest,
then another space nut, Framrick, Miko, Rich LB, Based Space Boris, MLLT, Warhawk, Lucky Green, and Centauri Sparrow. Thanks so much, guys. We really appreciate your help a lot.
And by the way, we organize everything for this channel on our Discord server. So if you want to join us, be sure to check out invite link in the video description.
So then, thanks for watching the JS Space Report, and I would say, on to the future. Wann der Feest.
Wann der Feest.
Wann der Feest.
Wann der Feest.
Perfect.